200 years ago, scientists named a dinosaur for the first time. It was called Megalosaurus, and the moment almost passed us by because at that time, we didn't actually know what a dinosaur was. That name, dinosaur, didn't come around until 20 years later. Since then, the field of paleontology has come on leaps and bounds, and we've got a whole cast of peculiar prehistoric characters to choose from, and scientists are discovering and naming new species every year. There are still big gaps in the geological record, which we don't know much about. Sometimes because we haven't found the fossils, sometimes because the animals that lived then don't transfer very well to the fossil record. And yes, I am talking about you, Megalodon. Why would you have bones made out of cartilage? To mark 200 years since the naming of Megalosaurus, I'm here at the Natural History Museum in London to speak to one of their lead paleontologists, Professor Paul Barrett, about what we've learned about Megalosaurus, what we still don't know, and what he hopes we're going to find out about dinosaurs in the future. Professor Paul Barrett, it's so great to meet you.
Hi, nice to meet you this morning.
It's an exciting room to be in and a relevant one for today because we're here to talk about Megalosaurus. It's the first dinosaur named by a scientist. But am I right in thinking when they found it, we didn't know what dinosaurs were? So what did they think they were looking at?
That's exactly right. So this was named way back in 1824. And this was a number of years of people finding odd bones in the ground and wondering about them. But eventually they put two and two together and realized that these weren't just any old bones, but they were the bones of a giant reptile. And that's where the name Megalosaurus comes from. It means great lizard. And so what they thought it was just a souped-up, regular type of lizard. They thought it was essentially a huge iguana or a huge Komodo dragon type animal.
And who was making these early discoveries?
So it's actually named by a guy called William Buckland. And William Buckland was a cleric who was also a fellow at the University of Oxford. He was a very eminent geologist. He was one of the first geologists really going out into the UK and actually travelling abroad as well and looking at the rocks and trying to categorise them. And by doing that, he also started looking at the fossils inside them. And he also found a few other bones that were lying around in collections in Oxford that had been found by earlier workers and put them all together because he realised they were all part of the same creature.
But that word dinosaur, I think it was about 20 years before it came around. So how did we get from Megalosaurus to there?
So Megalosaurus appears in 1824 to much acclaim, like people have never really seen anything like this. And then more and more bones of these things start to come out from Oxfordshire and from Sussex and from Kent, and they start to be found in other parts of the UK. So museums start to build up collections of these. And then a couple of years later, after all of these remains have built up and various people have studied them, suddenly Richard Owen, who was the leading anatomist at the time, realised that these three animals had something in common. They weren't just big lizards or big crocodiles, they were something distinct. And that's what led him to come up with the name dinosaur in 1842. And it was his lobbying that actually got the Natural History Museum built in the first place.
And Megalosaurus, it was the first dinosaur named, but to our knowledge today, it wasn't the first. So which do we, at our present knowledge, think was the oldest dinosaur?
Megalosaurus is about 164 million years old from the middle part of the Jurassic period. The first dinosaurs that we know about for sure lived on Earth about 230 million years ago in what's called the Late Triassic period. And there are some hints that dinosaurs might have appeared even earlier. We actually have another fossil in this room that might be of an animal that's a bit older still, about 240 million years old, that is the contender for possibly the first dinosaurs to ever walk the Earth.
Megalosaurus, we talked earlier about how it was seen as this massive reptile and it gets given this name, but I'm always quite a big fan of the story of how I believe it was almost called scrotum humanum.
For a few hundred years before the material of Megalosaurus was found, a few odd bones were still turning up under the plough in places like Oxfordshire. And one of those bones is the end of a thigh bone. And this thigh bone has a very suggestive shape. It's just the end of a thigh bone. Initially, they thought it was part of an elephant and maybe the Romans had brought it over. Then they thought maybe it was part of a giant man. And that's when it starts to take a slightly kind of salacious turn, where they decide that this bit, if it was a giant man, was a very well endowed giant man, let's say. And so eventually this bit of bone became named scrotum humanum. But it turns out that that thigh bone is probably a bit of a Megalosaurus thigh bone. So I'm standing in front of a bunch of original bones of Megalosaurus. These ones were found way back in the 19th century from the same place that the original bones were found just outside Oxford. And the bone I'm touching just here is actually a shin bone of Megalosaurus. You can see it's about 70, 80 centimeters long, just to give you an idea of how big that animal is. And just below that, we have one of the hip bones of this animal as well. You can see pretty enormous. What we find is that this animal turns out to be about 9 meters in length, a very decently lengthened skull with lots of sharp pointed teeth. Those teeth are curved with lots of steak knife-like serrations running down the edges, suggesting that it was a meat eater. And this would have been an animal that was essentially at the time living on a bunch of tropical islands set in a shallow, warm sea. A little bit like, it's hard to imagine, but Oxford was a little bit like the Bahamas back in the Middle Jurassic. And this would have been the top predator on those islands, probably occasionally even swimming between them, feeding on the other animals that were living there.
Also, the word dinosaur, I believe there was a time where even that as a name almost fell out of use. How did we go from thinking that it might be an obsolete group to realizing that it was a very established group of animals?
Some people thought that dinosaurs formed a single group. Some people thought they had lots of different ancestors that we hadn't yet found, and there was a lot of confusion. But since about the 1980s, we've now had a consensus among scientists that they were a natural group, a single group with a common ancestor. And that common ancestor diversified into lots and lots of different sorts of dinosaurs that we see today. And those features are mainly to do with features of their hips, features of their legs, and a few other more esoteric features of their hands and their skulls.
So over the years, I think there's been a few species suggested from Megalosaurus, but now we think there's only one. What's the situation there?
So there's a single species at the moment, which is called Megalosaurus bucklandi. And that species name commemorates William Buckland, who described Megalosaurus in the first place. But over the years, a number of other big meat-eating dinosaurs were also thought to be called Megalosaurus. And this goes back to old ideas about how we would classify animals. And what we call a wastebasket taxon. Megalosaurus basically became a name that people would throw any big, large, meat-eating dinosaur into without really thinking about whether it was related to Megalosaurus or not. And over the years, there's been a very careful program to actually go through all of these species of Megalosaurus and work out, are they really Megalosaurus or are they actually something different? And what he found as he went through was that the only real species of Megalosaurus is Megalosaurus bucklandi.
So what do we know about bucklandi when it was living?
All of our finds are mainly of isolated bones, and that's because of the way that they were collected. But when we take all of those bones together, we can actually piece together quite a lot of the animal. And when we do that, what we find is that Megalosaurus was an animal that was up to about 9 meters long, so pretty hefty, large predator, would have walked on its hind legs only, like all the other meat-eating dinosaurs. And it came equipped, as you might guess, with like a large number of big, sharp, pointed teeth that it would have used for ripping through prey.
Across your career, what would you say have been some of the biggest steps we've made in our understanding of dinosaurs?
The first complete skeletons of dinosaurs that were found, which came along in the late 19th century, started to bring all those bits and pieces together and helped to show how many different types of dinosaurs we had and also what dinosaurs looked like. Then the next big leaps actually happen a bit later in the 20th century, when we start finding dinosaurs that have a number of features that are suspiciously like those in birds. And so the discovery of some small, fast-running, meat-eating dinosaurs in the 1960s with very bird-like features, very bird-like hands and hips and arms, started to suggest maybe birds and dinosaurs are linked. And then I'd say the final big leap forwards, if you like, was probably when we found dinosaurs on with feathers, which cemented that bird link and also brought in a lot of other things to do with behavior and the biology of dinosaurs that we now think about in a much more bird-like way than in a reptile-like way.
Is there anything about dinosaurs that you're kind of surprised we haven't yet discovered, or gaps that you thought we might have filled in by now?
When I used to give talks about dinosaurs 20 years ago when I was a PhD student, I used to say things stupidly like, we will never know the color of a dinosaur. But we now know the colours of some dinosaurs because of new chemical techniques and new types of fossils that have been found. So nowadays I never say we will never know this about dinosaurs because I've been proved wrong several times. but there are still lots of gaps in our knowledge about them. We know very little about how dinosaurs first start to take over. So we know a few early dinosaurs, but we don't really know why they survived a bunch of extinctions and went on to become the greatest animals on Earth. We also have lots of gaps in our knowledge about even very familiar dinosaurs. So things like T-Rex, which is a favorite for many people. We know lots about T-Rex thanks to having about 35 really good skeletons of it, and more are found every year. But we've never found a T-Rex egg or a T-Rex baby, and we have very little information on things like T-Rex skin. We're still waiting for new discoveries to come along to complete our picture of what they really look like.
What's been the key focus of your work?
So I spent a lot of time looking at skulls and teeth and working out how dinosaurs chewed up plant food. But as time's gone on, I've got more interest in looking at dinosaur relationship, how different types are related to each other. But actually, one of the main focuses of my work now is looking at the root of the dinosaur tree. Where did dinosaurs come from and how did they start to take over?
Megalosaurus hasn't necessarily been a key focus within that. And as we've already covered, it wasn't actually one of the oldest dinosaurs. Does it hold a special place in your heart as one of the first named?
Oh, well, it's going to hold a special place for every dinosaur paleontologist. It's literally the first dinosaur to receive a scientific name. So it's, if you like, it's the core of what everyone else does. It's like the founding point of where everything else we do comes from.
What are the questions about dinosaurs that you're hoping to answer next?
So what I'm really hoping to find out is how the biggest groups, bigger groups of dinosaurs are really related to each other, because there's still some debate about how the big groups are started their evolutionary journeys, and also to work out those transformations that take place in building each of the new dinosaur groups from this very basic stock that dinosaurs start from. So all of my focus now is mainly on getting into those very deep parts of the dinosaur tree.
Well, it's been amazing to chat to you on 200 years of Megalosaurus Day. Thank you so much for your time, Paul. It's been great to meet you.
No, it's been a great pleasure. Thanks for coming in.
So there you have it, 200 years since the first dinosaur was ever named, and we at IFLScience would like to wish you a very merry 200 years of Megalosaurus.